ladies and gentlemen. Good morning. Hello. 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 Good morning. Good morning. Thank you. A very warm welcome to the NLA for this morning's Tall Buildings Annual Survey. My name is Robert Gordon-Clark. I'm chairman of London Communications Agency. I'm delighted to welcome you all here on behalf of the NLA and GL Hearn and EG, the partners involved in bringing together this important report. Now, this morning's structure is I'm just going to chair this first bit, and Peter Murray will shortly set the scene for the report. And there'll be presentations from Nigel Evans, head of London Residential Research at EG, and then Stewart Murray, head of development group GL Hearn, formerly of the GLA Parish. After that, we'll have a short Q&A, and then there'll be three area focus looks. That's Sandra Roebuck from London Borough of Lambeth, looking at Nine Elms and Vauxhall. David West from Studio Egret West, looking at Barking and Dagenham. And finally, Gwyn, head of design at the City of London, looking at the city. And then there'll be a panel discussion, and we're delighted to have a really good lineup there. Rab Bennetts, Emily G from Historic England, Andy Reid from Mount Anvil, Barbara Weiss from Skyline Campaign, and Colin Wilson from the GLA, which Peter will chair to have a debate about the findings. A few housekeeping points. It's important, especially being in the building centre. If there is a fire alarm, that there are no ones expected this morning. If there are, please follow the signs out up the stairs or via there. It is being live streamed this morning, so if you've got colleagues who want to watch it, the streaming is available on Twitter, so do retweet that and encourage people to watch it on live stream. So we are being broadcast live from the NLA this morning for this report, which is great. Now, I just wanted to set a couple of context points really this morning. This time last year, when the survey was done, we were pre-Brexit. Well, the referendum was due to happen, but we weren't quite sure what the results were going to be. And a year later, of course, we're looking at the findings of the 2016 results in a very different light to where we might have been. Yesterday, Wednesday, of course, the Prime Minister triggered the start of the process. And this week, there's been a lot of reports about what businesses might be doing in relation to London. My office is currently trying to keep a tally of this. And at the moment, approximately 10,000 jobs appear to be leaving London in various clumps and sizes to different places in Europe. No single business appears to be going, but bits of business appear to be going. Mark Boliat from the City of London Corporation on the news this week estimated maybe up to 70,000 jobs might leave. Now, conversely, looking at the signals, Siemens committing further investment here, the Qataris committing further investment, other businesses saying they're going to put more investment into London. And we're all trying to read the runes. What does this mean for this great capital city? So this report about the status of tall buildings as one indicator of London's health is perhaps one of the most interesting bellwethers that we now have for the health of our capital city. And perhaps next year's survey will be even more important than this as we try and assess the impact of the changes for London and the UK. So with that in mind, I'm now going to hand over to Peter Murray, chairman of the NLA, to kickstart the proceedings, and I'll be chairing a short question and answer after the three presentations. Peter, over to you.
Thank you very much, Robert. I'm just going to give an introduction into the survey in general before we get into some of the detail. And I know there are some people here today perhaps not totally familiar with NLA and its activities. The NLA is, I'd say, the centre for debate and discussion about issues to do with the built environment in London. And we have a pretty intense programme here looking at a whole range of issues, of which probably the Tall Building Survey is perhaps obviously the highest profile. And I think that we would see the context of tall buildings in London part of an inexorable shift amongst cities everywhere, that it's not so much not having taller buildings, but it's about doing them properly and getting them right. And of course, I mean, I just put together a few little slides to give some sort of context to all this, because back before 1930, you couldn't build over 80 feet. The 1930 London Building Act allowed you to go up another 20 feet, which was a huge change. And so we've got the Senate House by Charles Holden, which is still a commanding building on the skyline. And the height of buildings then was how long was a fireman's ladder? Then after the war, 1951, the LCC set plot ratios. There was the repeal of the London Building Act in 1956, which removed heights for control for buildings. And then we had the first phase of residential development with some clearance, post-war council house building, of course, which we know delivered lots of figures, but not always at the right sort of quality. And subsidies, government subsidies, encouraged high-rise. The LCC and the GLA built no less than 300 towers themselves, and the local authorities delivered large numbers. Then the collapse of Rondon Point, 1968, stopped that programme in its tracks, and in the following years, Hackney alone blew up 19 blocks because there were fears over their safety. And then there was a phase of office building starting 1961. The Empire State Building in West Brompton was the first, and then followed a whole series. Of course, Centrepoint just down the road here, the Hilton, Lancaster Gate, Vickers Building, Centrepoint, and The Economist, which The Economist is now going for its third phase of a retrofit now as the economists themselves move out. And then as the 70s began really with reaction against both residential tall buildings, that also spilled over into a reaction against tall buildings within commercial areas. And from really 1970 to 1990, there was pretty much a hiatus against tall buildings until One Canada Square, the first building in Canary Wharf, was completed in 1990. And 10 years later, the City of London reacted, and they then gave planning permission in 2000 to 30 St Mary Axe, or the Gherkin, as many people know it. And that led on to the development of the Eastern Cluster in the city, and permitted, as it were, in terms of attitude to all buildings, the development of the Shard and Vauxhall Tower. Of course, Ken Livingstone was very keen on tall buildings. He saw it as an international billboard for London. And then Boris was initially against electioneering. He criticised Ken's strategies, but when he got into power, he widened the view corridors, but then carried on business as usual. And then in the last part of the first decade, the sort of second phase of Boris's mayoralty, we started to see this real shift in the number of towers beginning to come through bit by bit, one by one. And they started to add up something which we thought was what would turn out indeed to be a seismic shift in the way London was beginning to shape up. And so we felt we ought to look into this, and we started the tall building survey, really with the idea of showing what the accumulated impact of this the growth in London and the need to accommodate growing population. And so now we have Sadiq Khan working on his new London plan. And you know, he has said that he wants stronger policies that ensure tall buildings respect the character of existing neighbourhoods, but nevertheless accepts that tall buildings in the right places, well-designed tall buildings, are appropriate for London. And so we need to look forward to see how that will be implemented within the new London plan, which a draft will be coming out in the autumn. Nobody quite knows precisely when autumn is these days, but it will be sometime probably later in the year. So one of the key things that we feel is making sure that not that we don't build tall buildings, but we build the right ones in the right place. And I'm very pleased, actually, that you know, the survey has generated a very wide debate about issues like this, and I'm very pleased that we have people like Barbara Weiss, who she and I keep turning up on television programmes, and we sort of put it either end of the spectrum. But I think to have, might say, intelligent critiques is much better than the knee-jerk reactions you find so much in the press and frequently in the Evening Standard from one particular journalist. It is a lively debate, I think, one that London desperately needs. It's what we feel at the NLA we're here to do, to encourage that debate so that we can create a better city going forward. And you know, there is a lot to talk about, and we're going to hear shortly about the actual figures that this year's survey produces. But I think we need to see that in context, how we manage this. And in a moment, you will hear from the city, how they're dealing with it, very excellent way. But that's only going so far. What we need to do is to encourage the mayor, and I know that Colin Wilson is going to speak shortly. They are making good progress in City Hall towards having a model of London where developers, planners, and communities can actually see what the impact of proposals is. And I put this up here. This is Virtual Singapore, which is going to be implemented at the middle of this year, produced by Dassault, the people who do all the 3D modeling for Frank Gehry, and also French military providers. But they are creating a very sophisticated, smart system for Singapore, which not only allows people to see what is happening to the city, but also inserts all the necessary BIM data and other management elements that go into a smart city, that sort of thing that London needs today. So with that, I will hand back to Robert.
Thank you, Peter. So we're now going to invite... So I thought we were going to do it seamlessly, but it doesn't matter too much. We're now going to hand over to Nigel Evans, Head of London Residential Research at EG, who's going to give a short presentation on the findings. Over to you.
Ooh. Was there a clicker? It's okay. Good morning, my name is Nigel Evans, Head of London Residential Research, EG, that's the States Gazette. We've been rebranded. I've got 5 minutes to talk about the London Tower pipeline. And here is that pipeline, starting off with applications, 63 towers at application stage, 256 permissions, and 91 at under construction. Now, pre-planning, we've got 36 at EIA, or scoping options, and 7 rumours that they will enter the planning system at some point. 455 in total compared to 436 from the previous year. But there's an element here that we're not talking about, and we should do. Of the 91 under construction, there are 48 starts. What do I mean by that? 48 starts in 2016. So let's have a look at those starts. Brace yourselves. It was a record-breaking year for construction starts, from a mere 6 in 2009 to a whopping 48 in 2016. A 68% increase on the previous year and a massive 700% increase on that 2009 low. Or to put yet another way, one tower coming out of the ground every week, more or less. So, bungalows on a map, and it looks a bit like this. This is a timeline from 2006 to 2016, showing towers, bigger the circle, bigger the tower. I'll zoom forward to 2016, and you can see a pattern emerging here. What we have is a necklace of towers, bookended in the east by the Dogs and in the west by VNEBOA, Vauxhall 9, Elms, Battersea, Opportunity Area, mine Elms. Interesting, I'm sure this will be expanded on later. It's not the whole picture. Okay, applications. Applications are down, caveat, apparently. Let's unpack that statement. This is the application rate, 2004 to 2016, with a whopping spike in 2015. But that spike looks a bit like, oops, looks a bit like that. But bear in mind, it came from just one scheme, Greenwich Peninsula in LBKD, London Borough of Night Dragon, as we're calling it. It's true. But if you take those applications away, those 40 applications, this pipeline is remarkably consistent. And it has been for 4 years. Could call it consistent, you could call it flatlining, but it's amazingly consistent. Okay, completions. Guess what? Completions. It was a record year for completions as well. This is the completion rate from 2004 to 2016. And we're predicting future completions based on what is under construction at the moment, 2017, 2018, 2019. This is the wave of construction, and it peaks at there, 40 towers we're predicting in 2018. So there is more to come, but this pattern of delivery is very similar. Now it's time for a theory. Theory of as to how the construction in towers in 1 year lowers the number of completions in the next. It's not very complicated. A 300 unit, I'm calling it horizontal development, will pump out phase chunks of, say, 100 per year. Whereas a tower has to complete before any of those units can be occupied. So what you're getting is huge dumps of units coming onto the market all at once in this sawtooth pattern, as opposed to an appropriately flatline delivery from horizontal schemes. And if we superimpose that curve that we just seen on completions, it kind of matches that. Okay, it's a bit more extreme, but it is peak, trough, peak, trough, peak, trough. So what does this snapshot tell us about the strength of the market in a post Brexit environment? Nothing much, really. The residential industry and towers especially are very slow to react to unexpected. Things have been unexpected market changes. In the main, once you start a tower, you cannot stop. Don't think surfer, think more super tanker. So what we can predict, because we're seeing it happening right now, is the tenure of towers will change from high-end residential to the almost polar opposite. I call it IPRS, institutional private rented sector. It hasn't caught on. People are still insisting on calling it build to rent, but I'm calling it IPRS. So with own occupation numbers falling and increasing numbers of investor sales, we may well be on the cusp of a paradigm shift away from owner-occupier-dominated market to a rental-dominated one. This is a market that is becoming increasingly polarized, with rent on one side, sale on the other, or should I say homes on one side and investments on the other. Thank you very much for listening. Enjoy the rest of your day.
You win the graphics award, certainly, for me. And also, I point out, I just think you'd rename two boroughs. First, we've now got just the London Borough of Dogs, apparently. Is that right? And obviously, the London Borough of Night Dragon, which could join perhaps the London Borough of Tottenham instead of Haringey, London Borough of Heathrow instead of Hounslow, London Borough of Wimbledon instead of Merton. We could go on and on, but that was really great. Thank you for that headline summary. I was interested in listening to some gasps in the audience, a few gasps there at some of the findings. Which was great to hear, a bit of theatre there. Now, we're going to hand over to Stewart Murray from GL Hearn, who's going to do the next presentation. So over to you, Stewart.
I'm trying to think of another name of another borough, but I'll probably offend some people in the audience. So.
Wembley.
Yes. I did notice with Nigel's presentation that the spikes over a particular four-year period were probably when Colin and I at GLA were issuing quite a lot of new decisions on behalf of Boris in his final term. So on our watch, we have to take some responsibility for that, which is a good thing. Jill Hearn provided the data analysis with our friends that just presented, and I'm just going to look a bit more at how the methodology works and how we got to where we are, and that fantastic trend where you've just seen the direction of travel. And of course, the methodology is important that we get it right. That's not to be provocative. And we had that report about London's growing up. It's our fourth year of measuring this effectively. We're getting better at this data. The buildings measure tall buildings being 20 stories or more. Of course, 20 stories in a suburb can be considered very tall. 20 stories in probably Isle of Dogs is not necessarily considered very tall anymore, given what's coming up in South King Canary Wharf. So one has to put this into perspective. And so there's a bit of analysis around location, zones, and context. But we very much want to analyse where proposals are coming, not just applications, but the quantum of tall buildings within that. You've heard about the Greenwich Peninsula one having... and that's lights out today for tall buildings. Hopefully all the tall buildings didn't go dark either. We've got the data just as well as approved on proposed in pre-app, the approved under construction and completed. And of course you get, as Nigel said, you get this sort of lumpiness in the figures. So it's important not to misinterpret what's going on in reality. And also I think it's very important is that often some buildings, we talk about new tall buildings. You know, London's full of buildings that have been quite tall, been around for quite a while, and not necessarily been that beautiful or complementary to London's skyline. And they're coming down and being replaced by other buildings which may not have been as tall as what they could have been. So planning works, I would suggest. Maybe there's a push to be even more planning focus on tall buildings. But here is where it's all happening. So you heard from Nigel, by borough, the predominant number of tall buildings happening in boroughs is Tower Hamlets because of Isle of Dogs and South Quay. If you go and look at the model, which I think, as Peter said, the 3D model of where change is happening at South Quay, south of Canary Wharf, is absolutely dramatic, and there's more to come. I know the Colin and GLA are going to be issuing an opportunity area planning framework, which I'm sure would include tall buildings analysis in the Isle of Dogs. Greenwich is the night dragon phenomenon, and that single application, which is going to create a whole new cluster on the peninsula, has had a dominant effect. But there are other boroughs. There's Lambeth. I know Sandra Roebuck's here today, with all the area around Vauxhall, which is part of the Nine Elms Battersea Opportunity Area, and the Shell development along the South Bank, and Southwark with Blackfriars and the Elephant Castle. And increasingly, I think what's really interesting, the Outer London boroughs are starting to get their contribution of tall buildings. Croydon, Ealing, Barnet, and Newham. These are starting to come forward. It's a very distinct shift in the analysis. And in terms of sub-region, the east still dominates, nearly half, principally dominated by Tower Hamlets and Greenwich and the Isle of Dogs. And central London, in particular with the City of London, which Vauxhall 9M's Battersea falls within the sort of zone one of central London. And some of the other sub-regions are starting to catch up a bit now, so it'd be interesting where this might go in the future years. And in terms of zones, I think this is where it starts to get interesting. Predominantly, three quarters of tall buildings are taking place in zones one and two. Those big inner city opportunity areas that have come forward, the City of London, obviously Nine Elms Battersea, and including Canary Wharf. But this is the area to watch, I think, particularly zones three and four. We're starting to get more tall buildings in certain boroughs. Really interesting to note that nine London boroughs do not have what we call tall buildings yet. I'm not going to name them, they're in the report. However, there are some boroughs in that nine category where there are tall building proposals coming forward, and we're aware of the rumours. So it'll be interesting to see what happens. Even in Zone 5, which I think includes Croydon Town Centre, there are now substantial numbers of tall buildings in the pipeline. Zone 6 is yet to see one, and so that will be interesting where that goes. I think we'll be watching the Mayor's new London plan and what Colin and others bring forward in the various frameworks for tall buildings and the London View Management Framework in particular. So examples of where they're happening. So as I said, in Zone 3, we're starting to get new developments coming forward. In fact, this is one that I worked on many years ago in Barnet, where we were replacing what were considered tall buildings at the time with substantial new towers on estate regeneration. And Peter put up this one. I think you'll need to look closer in the report on this. The postcode analysis is very important to see where the dominance and the clusters of tall buildings is taking effect, particularly in Tower Hamlets and Greenwich, Nine Elms, Battersea, and obviously the City of London, and down to Battersea Power Station. So where are the new ones coming forward? The grey areas are quite interesting. They're starting to go further out of Zones 1 and 2, and probably some of these might turn grey, the purple ones, in the future. So what's really important is that tall buildings are now starting to make contribution across 24 London boroughs and an increasing contribution to housing as well as jobs. And that is a bit of a shift where we've seen maybe tall buildings as exceptions. Now, in terms of housing contributions, are they becoming mainstream provision of housing? And you can see that the dominant use is increasingly housing. So it'd be interesting to see what Gwyn Richards of the City of London says about offices and Canary Wharf. And this is where most of the debate takes place. So there seems to be less controversy about commercial towers, other than this one, I should say, replace that one, which was residential led. And residential towers, particularly on the South Bank, Nine Elms, and in Greenwich, are really getting controversy. And probably the biggest debate is what's happening in central London and the shift with Westminster. And interestingly, there have been quite a lot of write-ups this week in the press about where Westminster might go and whether that sets a precedent for that part of central London and for the rest of London. So I think very much we're looking for the leaders, the public sector, is to tell us where we are heading. I think this debate about Paddington, resi or offices versus tall poles or cubes, that's a little debate in itself. Where is London going to go in terms of activity uses, and how is that reflected physically in key opportunity areas? And in building height, the sweet spot is still this sort of 20, 29 stories and 30, 39, particularly in zones 1 and 2. There are not that many buildings in the upper category in zones 3 to 5. So predominantly the big towers, the big ones that get a lot of attention, like the Paddington Poles, very much in zone 1 or in Canary Wharf and South Quay and Greenwich Peninsula. And that trend seems to be continuing. However, we might get, with the direction of travel, with ambitious boroughs and developers, and particularly with the Mayor and the GLA pointing towards densification and higher buildings as landmarks in particular locations. So you heard about Tottenham. We know what Croydon has got, one of the tallest buildings in London, residential tower, more coming. And there'll be other outer London boroughs that may want to have their iconic contribution to mark a position of regeneration, high accessibility to transport, and to reflect their part of London's skyline. And I think this is what is really key, is the shift in construction. So we talked about this for many years, and the boroughs are now really coming forward in terms of construction, particularly in East London and in Lambeth and the South Bank. And there'll be more coming through the pipeline where you get this lumpiness, and that spike will come forward. Completions are now really pushing forward, as we've heard. You can see those boroughs, again, the dominance in the inner London boroughs, but some of those outer London boroughs starting to really come up. And where we thought we had clusters, we're now going to have new clusters coming forward across different parts of London. So some observations. Many of the tall buildings, I think Colin might mention this, fall within opportunity areas or identified areas for regeneration and tall buildings. But what the Mayor says about the new London plan and the refresh of the London View Management Framework will be very key. Westminster shifting its policy, where will that take us for central London? Pushed by the Mayor for higher density in the suburbs, particularly zones 3 to 5. Bit of market uncertainty with Brexit, will that affect the city, will that affect the commercial towers? Housing numbers, now we've got 100,000 homes across the whole pipeline contributing to housing in London, so is that mainstream? Paper towers, how many are actually not built, never built, even with planning permission? At the moment, the report only says about 5 are about 5 years old, unlikely to be built. And finally, is London's tall buildings approach influencing other regions? So here in Manchester, we have the Beacon Tower, and there's a 66-storey tower coming forward. Liverpool got ambitions. Is this where we go next? So read the report, form your own opinion, and let's take forward the next stage of debate. Thank you.
Thank you much indeed, Stuart. I'm conscious we're running a few minutes behind the schedule to aim to finish by 10:30, but I've just had the cue that we'd like 5 minutes of Q&A now. Can I kindly ask for you to give your name and your organisation, and if you can try and make it a question at this stage, there'll be further questions later, from the initial findings. So anyone like to kick off with a question, comment, observation on what they've seen to date? And we have some mics, I think, available. And then no questions? Oh, great. Okay, we got two here. And actually, can I ask Peter, could you just come up, and perhaps Stuart, all three of you, actually, if you could come up, Nigel, as well. Thank you. Question, the gentleman here, I think, and then the lady at the front as well. Oh, yes, I know that lady. Yeah. Thank you.
Now that we're seeing significant completions, who is analysing the performance of these buildings, both in terms of residents' expectations, in terms of turnover, and so on and so forth? Because it seems to me that the critical issue, if we're going to have lots more, is to understand what's going on in the ones we've already finished.
In fact, I should take two, actually. Here, and then we'll take those two first, and then the gentleman behind after that.
Rosemary McQueen, I know there was a brief discussion about Brexit, but I'd quite like to know what analysis there is of the funding changes in terms of who's paying for the towers.
Okay, so management post-building and funding. Any comments from the panel?
I have to say that we aren't at the moment, but I think it's absolutely something that we will keep an eye on, because I think the long-term effect of the management costs of taller buildings, who is actually living in them, that's proved really difficult to get accurate figures on, but I do think that's something which, as we have more buildings, that is an additional part of research that we ought to carry out in future years.
I think I'd also comment that it would be actually a good quality of life indicator in maybe future research analysis to include and survey the occupiers of tall buildings and the people that manage those and provide them. I know that individual developers like Bartley Homes often survey their residents after they've moved in and after a few years, and they do analysis on that, on quality of life and their preferences of whether living in a 30-storey tower as opposed to a 2-storey traditional house. And what facilities that brings forward. I think it would be interesting, it might be a bit of a debate of how you come to a consensus about measuring those, but increasingly as they become more mainstream, in particular on providing housing as well as jobs, that could be a big indicator for the future's analysis.
Anything on the funding side from Rosemary?
Can I just say one thing on the looking at what the occupiers will be thinking? It's when I mentioned tenure shift, I think this is key. What we're going to get is a shift from owner occupation to renting. And renting will, there's a lot of talk of placemaking, but a rented tower is intrinsically different to a sold tower. Once you build a tower and you sell it, that's it, you don't come back. If you build a town, you rent it, you're there for a long, long period, and it's in your interest to make sure that town is well kept. It's an interesting place to be, and I think that monitoring the residents in a rented tower will be very interesting.
Okay, I think we've got time actually just for one more question, so maybe yours later on.
We answered the finance one.
We didn't answer the finance one, but Stewart, do you just want to do that, and then this gentleman here?
Yeah, I mean, I don't have any detailed analysis. I know we've got other speakers like Gwyn Richards speaking in the city, but from what we hear anecdotally, there was an article in the Standard this week, I think, about all tall buildings go bust or they don't make
Anthony
any money.
Anthony Hilton. Yes,
I think that was slightly controversial. I'm not sure where. Using a couple of examples like Canary Wharf and others, there are lots of tall buildings that are funded by equity funders. There are obviously international investors. There are companies like Berkeley Homes often funds itself. So people are funding these through different mechanisms. I suppose the issue will be where is this going for the future, and whether there is an appetite, particularly with Brexit and concerns about the future, that continuing funding, particularly for the very tall buildings, will come forward. I suppose the litmus test will be the City of London and South Quay and Canary Wharf, because that's where the most challenging and high-risk towers will be.
Okay. And then just one more question and we'll move on. Those who want to ask a question will be later on. Please make sure there's two here, Peter, for later, when you get to this gentleman here, and then we'll move on.
Michael Bach, London Forum. James Murray said of some of the buildings built in Islington that they were wasted sites. In other words, they didn't provide the housing that was needed. Tall buildings that don't get built are wasted sites, and tall buildings that do get built but don't provide housing for Londoners could equally be regarded as wasted sites. The opportunity cost is very high if we don't build them and if we do build them. Could you say when we will know who's occupying these and whether they are genuinely playing a role in providing housing for Londoners?
Okay, thank you.
I'll make a comment that the mayor was very clear in his statement, which I'm sure Colin will comment, that tall buildings should not only be in the right location of the outstanding quality, but they should, where they're residential, make a contribution to London's housing needs. And very importantly, I think it is key to measure, particularly residential development in the towers, that they are being occupied by people that need those homes. Of course, I think the data at the moment is very patchy on this. Some boroughs like Islington have been much more forward thinking about it in terms of measuring that. That might be difficult logistically. But importantly, I think most residential towers and accommodation ultimately comes onto the market. It might be funded or purchased by different people. And there's a lot of controversy about foreign investors and buy to leave. I don't think anyone really knows how many empty high-end super prime properties are actually left wasted, as you call it. I know everyone talks about the Hyde Park Barracks site. Sorry, Hyde Park. But I think they're very minority. Most mainstream tower residential homes come onto the market, they're rented to Londoners and to local people. What we need is more data on that.
Right, I'm now going to hand over to Peter, I think, for the second session. Thank you. Could you thank our speakers for the first session? Thank you.
Right, thank you very much, Robert. So, yes, now we're on to the second part of the programme, where we're going to hear from various speakers who will comment on tall buildings that in areas they're involved with, how you deal with them, and the impact of some things they have heard this morning. So, first of all, we're going to hear from Sandra Roebuck, who's Assistant Director Investment and Growth at London Borough Lambeth, and she's going to talk about the Vauxhall Nine Elms area, which of course is one of those key opportunity areas and tall buildings clusters. So, Sandra, over to you.
Good morning, everyone. I'll just start by saying it's Lambeth, and it's definitely Lambeth, and I don't want any changes of names during the course of this morning. As Peter said, I'm going to talk about the Vauxhall cluster essentially, but with a particular reference, I've been asked to talk about some of the housing components, but also the wider regeneration benefits that we are securing. I seem to have lost the main screen. Is that? Do I need to go? I'm going the wrong way. Sorry. Can someone help me with that? There we go. Sorry. So for those of you, sorry about that. For those of you who don't know, the Vauxhall Nine Elms opportunity area is essentially covers Wandsworth and Lambeth. It's a project venture that we've undertaken together. It's approximately 20,000 new homes, and we hope as a minimum 25,000 new jobs. The basic spatial principles of the Vauxhall Nine Elms area were that would be two growth poles. One of those would be at Battersea Power Station with an amazing new town centre, and the second would be at Vauxhall, where we would create a new district centre for the borough, anchored essentially around a number of tall buildings. I think one of the things to say at the outset in terms of the approach to housing is that Wandsworth and Lambeth do approach affordable housing in this area in a different way. Colleagues at Wandsworth agreed at the outset that they would seek a 15% contribution to affordable housing from development. In Lambeth, we chose to apply our policy, which is up to 40% affordable housing. And I'm pleased to say the most recent scheme that we granted planning permission for a couple of weeks ago is actually 40% affordable housing, with 30% of that being on site. And that's the redevelopment of the Texaco garage on the Albert Embankment, for those of you who might know it. I think the second thing to say, one of the principles across the whole area, is that very early on, with the help of the GLA, we did adopt something called the Development Infrastructure Tariff. And that really allowed us to approach the whole of the area with a quite a different perspective to some of the other examples that have come forward, because we looked at infrastructure planning very early on as an absolute fundamental principle to support the development of not only tall buildings, but obviously this whole new community. And in Lambeth in particular, we're looking at 3,500 new homes at least, which is actually the equivalent of adding a whole extra ward to the borough in quite a small part of the geography. So when we started the story, the top line shows where we were existing. For those of you who back in the day might have driven up to London, which we obviously don't do now, you would have seen a very industrial landscape coming through Nine Elms, very low rise, very industrial, with the exception obviously of the power station. The tall buildings policy that we put in place with the GLA is the middle bar there, where we looked essentially at we were talking about 150 metres as being the guideline for the cluster of tall buildings at Vauxhall. The Albert Embankment, we talked about 90 metres as an upper threshold, and we talked about a stepping down into Wandsworth of about 70 metres as you go towards the River Light. The bottom diagram just shows you how that's come out in practice. Obviously, not quite the flat bar that we had in the middle, which the policy set, but some interesting responses to those height guidelines. And I think it's fair to say that obviously in the cluster, we've gone beyond some of those original guidelines that we had thought about as architecture has taken over policy to create something interesting and innovative. In the supplementary planning document that the council adopted after the opportunity area framework, actually, we tried to translate those broad guidelines into something a bit more detailed. And one thing I would say that hasn't been mentioned so far is the influence of heritage and historic buildings on this debate. And obviously, we have the Palace of Westminster there influencing very heavily what can happen in Westminster and Lambeth. And Colin, who's in the audience, we had the pleasure of the ICOMOS visit a couple of weeks ago, where they are taking a very strong view about the future of the Palace of Westminster and what is appropriate to take place around it. In the beginning, we did very simple sketches here. It's interesting to see how the graphics have moved on, just showing what we thought was going to be happening, what was tall, what was short, how appropriate the cluster might be. I'll just pick out the orange one in there. The smaller orange one is the Market Towers building, which has been subsequently demolished and replaced by the two towers still in orange there on that bar, which just shows the difference between what was existing and what people expect to be able to build now. Just to take you back, that is the existing area as it was probably actually only 5 years ago, in fact. The pace of change here has been absolutely phenomenal, I think it's fair to say. So a very low-rise landscape. The big block is the Covent Garden Market building, just to anchor your geography, which is also the subject of redevelopment, to include brand new market facilities, actually. I've called this the finished article, but nothing's really ever finished, I don't think, in this sort of project, obviously. But you can see the change in density of development that's proposing and the tall building cluster for Vauxhall in the sort of background to that photo. And the foreground is obviously the power station in all its glory, redeveloped and refurbished as a town centre. It all started here. This is the St George Tower. We didn't give planning permission for this. John Prescott gave planning permission for this, one of the last things he did before he left office. It's also the tower that very tragically was hit by the helicopter, which led to some rethink around tall buildings and lighting and the CAA and the approach to that in the centre of London. In terms of where the affordable housing is, there is no affordable housing in the tower. The permission that was given put the affordable housing in the lower block, and we achieved 35% affordable housing in this scheme with grant at that time, and there are 60 families now living in that area. The tower is often the subject of discussion in the Evening Standard, as I'm sure you'll have read, with who is occupying what. A view of the Vauxhall cluster as it was intended, you can see on the skyline and the proximity of the river to that cluster. We started to look at what it looks like by day, and here are a couple of examples there. You can see on the left of that, on the left of the shot there, oops, sorry, I've lost my clicker. This tower here is the Wanda Tower, which is the redevelopment, Chinese development, which is going to be a new hotel and some offices. It has started on site, but it is very slow, and I am told that they've had 3 change of contractors, so that does say something about the challenge of building development of this scale. This is the Sky Gardens, which is now complete. Again, one of the earlier schemes that was granted permission, now complete. We have the Keybridge House development that is also under construction at the moment, and I'm told will be the tallest brick tower in Europe when it's finished. It's moving so fast in Vauxhall that though at night I've had an extra couple of towers into the scheme. Here is the Vauxhall Square scheme, which is in the middle of the Vauxhall cluster. That comes with a brand new public square and some student accommodation that is already under construction. I think some of the challenges around these towers have been things like daylight sunlight. Lots of negotiation has had to happen around that, even post-planning, where those issues have sort of come into play. We're very focused on what's happening on the ground. We're about to go out to consultation with Transport for London with the new bus station for Vauxhall. Much of that focus has been on removing the gyratory and recreating street scenes, streets, proper streets and places for people to use. It's not just all about big development. The removal of the gyratory does create the setting for that development, and it's one of the projects that the council and TfL have been very focused on. And as you can see from the shot, the discussion we've had at length with developers is what happens at the ground floor, and is it all retail and cafe use, or can we actually look at something more creative, such as affordable workspace, which is the kind of conversations we're starting to have. So it's not just the long views that are important, it's the short views. This is the view of the Vauxhall cluster from Vauxhall Pleasure Gardens. We have a very thriving business improvement district in Vauxhall, which is now benefited, I think, from obviously this type of development, but is also starting to respond to it in terms of the programme and the opportunities they are putting on. I won't go through all these dots, but as I mentioned before, this is the sort of extent of change over 5 years. Every one of those dots marks something that is now different to what it was if you'd driven through this area 5 years ago. I didn't mention the Northern Line extension, but obviously one of the pivotal pieces of infrastructure that has allowed this to go ahead is a new piece of rail infrastructure, which is the Northern Line, which is also under construction with a new station at Kennington. Here are some of the consented schemes. So very quickly, in the top here is the Albert Embankment Barclay cluster, if I can put it that way. 2 of those towers currently under construction, the 3rd one about to start. We have the Sainsbury's development, which is the store is now complete and operating. The towers are still under construction, working with Barratt's. We have Vauxhall Square, which I mentioned, which is about to start construction. The student accommodation is underway. New Bondway, for those of you who know, it's where the old self-storage building used to be on the gyratory. That's now been demolished and is under construction with Damac. It's now been renamed Icon. You might have seen the Saatchi interior adverts that went out some time ago for that building. The Atlas is essentially a student accommodation. It includes a swimming pool in the basement that we've negotiated for the use of the community part of the time, the wider community. And the bottom one there is the Keybridge House scheme, where we are currently working with Mount Anvil to develop a new school as part of a later phase, which will be funded pretty much wholly by the development, and then we will use the money we would have spent on the school to improve the environment across the area yet further. I think it wouldn't be complete without also mentioning the island site. This is also a scheme that we didn't give planning permission for. The Secretary of State, Eric Pickles, then gave planning permission for this tower, these two towers. I think we always felt it was before its time. We've been working really hard with the developer to try and create something which is much more comprehensive and befitting of a town centre. So we don't think it'll ever be completed, but it has started on site, it has officially started on site. And there's been a long legal battle about what the definition of start on site actually means. So the culmination of all of this, including the Nine Elms, is new underground stations, hopefully opening in 2020. The new district centre with 28,000 square metres of new retail. We're also having the debate about, because this cluster straddles the two boroughs, you know, where is the boundary? What is that in definition terms? We are progressing with the transformation of Vauxhall Cross. It's a £50 million scheme to remove Vauxhall Gyratory. It's in TfL's business plan, and I say that wherever I get the opportunity in public, so it can't be reconsidered. New bus station, public realm improvements, start on site probably 2019-2020, subject to planning permission. We are expanding the existing primary school and building a new building with Mount Anvil. We've recently given permission for the expansion of three new doctor surgeries coming out of our community infrastructure levy. Our first new cinema is coming forward as part of Vauxhall Square and the swimming pool. And of course, we've had a wholesale shift in the cultural offer in this part of the borough, with particularly, obviously, people like Damien Hirst opening their gallery, but others actually, the Beaconsfield Gallery, and a whole range of other things that are coming forward. We've started our cultural programme working with schools, actually, sponsored by developers. So we're working with the local schools, not only actually in the north, but also in the south of the borough, to talk about planning and urban design and the importance of that to London as a place, not only to meet housing need, but generally across. So I said I'd talk a bit about housing. Here's the list of housing numbers in Lambeth. We have granted planning permission for 3,900 units in the last, I think, 3 to 4 years. 700 of those are affordable units, which will be mostly on site. Our policy is very much to go on site first and foremost. If we do adopt a different approach, we have to have a development within a half a kilometre of the main scheme. So we're very focused on ensuring that affordable housing happens where the main development is. So I'm going to bring you right back to basics, to the farm, to finish my presentation. One of the benefits of this programme is the huge number of jobs it will bring. Employment and skills is very important to the borough, and I have often said before that I think if anybody put their hand up and say, I want to be a certain type of job, you will find it in Vauxhall Nine Elms, because the diversity is enormous. This is one of the local schemes that has really benefited from the level of development. As part of the Barclay Group, we negotiated some affordable housing on site, but also some new community space for the Vauxhall Farm to underpin its vitality into the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sandra. And now we're going to move further east and to Barking and Dagenham. And I had to just check on the map. Actually, Barking is in Zone 4. I thought it was Zone 5, but it's Zone 4. And so David West, founding director of Studio Egret West, is going to talk about tall buildings in Zone 4.
Good morning. I'm David West from Studio Egret West, and I'm sort of aware that it's going to get a bit heated this morning, I'm assuming, because we're going to talk about tall buildings. Tall buildings, to me, is probably about as divisive a topic as Brexit's been in my family, as I sort of discuss with my parents continually, why. And I hear our esteemed country leader say Brexit means Brexit, and I think today, do tall buildings mean tall buildings? And of course, as ridiculous as Brexit means Brexit is, tall buildings mean tall buildings is just as ridiculous a thing to say, because of course they're not all the same. And just to be completely clear about this, I am a fan of some tall buildings. I love some tall buildings. Just as other people, I hate other tall buildings. I love the Shard. I hate the one that burns people. It's really simple, and it's really guttural. And that's just, I didn't say what it was. My studio is a lovely studio, and I'm very proud of it, and we're 60 people strong, and we're responsible for 20,000 homes, the design of 20,000 homes in this city. It's an incredible responsibility, it's an incredible burden, and we design homes from 2 stories to 45 stories. And we hope that we design good things, hopefully wonderful things. Sometimes not quite so wonderful things, but we do our very best with whatever we're given. We do design buildings from Zone 6 to Zone 1. I'm going to talk very much about Barking. I'm going to spend 1 minute talking about Mill Harbour, 1 minute talking about Chiswick, because it would be rude not to sort of throw that into the mix, and then about 7 minutes talking about Barking. I'll do it as fast as I can. This is Mill Harbour. It's in South Quay, in an area of tall buildings. And it was a scheme that we inherited after 5 years of punch-ups. Everybody hated the scheme. Then we were lucky enough to win the commission to rethink the scheme. It's 1,500 homes in 6 buildings. The lowest building is 35 stories, the tallest building is 47 stories. I went to a number of consultations, always expecting that everybody would say, "I hate your scheme, I hate tall buildings." Not a single person said that. In fact, everybody said, "I love your scheme." We didn't have any objections to this scheme because actually everybody cared about play. They cared about schools. They cared about all the stuff on the ground floor, because really that's the game changer. And these buildings helped create an amazing sense of place, an amazing sense of play, an amazing set of playgrounds, sports facilities, incredible new theatre, incredible new Montessori school, a new dance academy, and a new state public school, plus, 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 plus. And we made sure that we gave back so much stuff to the local community that it made a difference. So yes, I stood with a big model in my hand saying, "Tell me you hate tall buildings," and no one did. I thought it was really interesting. It was a huge lesson for me as the person trying to lead the design. And yet, a couple of months later, I find myself in Chiswick, where actually there's a huge amount of things planned. There's a huge amount of things consented. Lots of things that are definitely tall buildings. Lots of things that are definitely going to change the skyline. But yet when we came along and started to look at this rather tricky site over here next to this roundabout, which already had something called the Octopus on it, already consented, and a client with a 16-storey consent already consented that he could go and build with a big, fat office, corporate, bleh, which he didn't want to build, I found myself completely and utterly barraged with negativity. Absolutely, from day one. "You're going to design a monster. It's absolutely outrageous." I've even got some of the quotes on my phone if I forget. "But monstrous, monstrous thing in this absolutely stunning environment of B&Q." I don't want to make light of this, but in this absolutely stunning environment of B&Q, the M4 slices its way through communities. I didn't do that. That happened about 50 years ago, right? Just dealing with it. I remember I took my children there and stood there completely and utterly alienated by all sorts of heavy traffic, horrible, 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 horrible environment. I said, "Kids, do you reckon we should build a tower here?" And they said, "Well, yeah, maybe we should, because actually we'll be getting up and away from the really horrible environment. But only if you make something better on the ground floor, Papa. Only if you improve the kind of the roundabout and help people cross the road." I said, "Good idea, kids. This monstrous, monstrous thing. Look at it. It's monstrous. It's wicked. It's evil. I mean, what a monstrous tower. I mean, come on." I mean, in all seriousness, this could have been a really terrible, terrible tower proposition, because we actually inherited somebody else's design, and it was singular, big, fat, "I am the monster tower." And we said, "Why can't we break down the mass of a building like that? Why can't we actually try and make our own cluster? Why can't we step and step and step? Why can't we actually spend most of our time designing this completely unsustainable tower," by the way, in all the press, unsustainable tower. I mean, I'm not even going to present this slide to you. It's effortlessly sustainable tower, an absolute exemplar of sustainability and mixed use, with absolute massive upgrade of all of the connections around the kind of the public realm to help people cross the road, to make it a much better environment, to lift the skirt of the building, to create a wonderful oasis. It is really wicked around that environment, to allow people in an amazing section of 6 stories of affordable workspace, creche, gallery, all completely and utterly governed to be affordable throughout. Wonderful environment, incredible piece of design, and yet 400 plus objections unanimously rejected. Yes, the monster's dead. Absolutely ridiculous. Yeah, embarking, No one said. No one said. Monster, wicked, bad, boo. They said, let's talk about regeneration. Let's talk about good design. Let's talk about quality of public realm. Let's talk about aggregation. Let's talk about conservation areas that step and step and step. Let's talk about change, because change is coming, and we recognise that. Let's not hide from change. But let's make it good. So we don't want a big, fat, slab building that's going to sort of dominate the scene at the train station. No, we don't want that. Can we actually make something that has an articulated skyline that can step and can actually create light through to the station? Can we make something that actually creates a new house for the barking bathhouse, a wonderful pop-up that we've tried that we'd like to see going forward, a well-being centre? And can you kind of step it to make sure that everybody gets fantastic views? How about making it like a series of drums? Okay, interesting conversation. Can you land it? Can you actually make a decent enough street frontage in an area which, frankly, is a bit cowboy at night time, you know, a bit... Can you actually sort of do your best to sort of integrate it into the street scene? Yes, good conversation. I'm going to hit that too. Can we make a wonderful lobby space? Can we make a set of gardens that pull down? And can we actually make a building that Barking can be proud of? Yes, we can. And you know what? The entire first phase is sold to proper Londoners incredibly quickly. Our Swan Housing Group client are actually promoting a really genuinely affordable, accessible development, and it's going to be wonderful. I'm absolutely categorically sure of that. And that inspired even greater confidence, may I say, in Barking to actually do something even bigger and better. The Vicarage Field, two-storey, monocultural, monoslab nothingness of an environment that dominates the town centre. Let's knock it down. Let's open up some spaces. Let's open up new routes. Let's open new public realm. Let's make that public realm multi-layered. Probably my most beautiful plan, I think I've ever seen from the studio. Multi-layered, coalescing landscapes, a true exemplar of ecological urbanism, growing and growing and growing up multiple planes. And yes, it's going to have some tall buildings. And yes, I hope they're going to be beautiful. But it's also going to be 35,000 square feet of retail space, a cinema, a theatre, a three-form entry primary school, 150-room hotel, plus, 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 alongside 850 new homes for London. And we need homes. And yes, it's going to be unusual. And yes, it's going to coalesce. And yes, it's going to aggregate. And yes, it's going to grow. And it won't be one single big look-at-me iconic mass. Why should it be? It should actually just be sort of rooted and rooted and rooted and rooted. And we think that's much more the important thing. AHMM did a superb job changing the culture of Barking's architecture. And all we're doing is saying, thanks, Paul, tag team, and we'll carry on. And it's very, very exciting to see that level of ambition and that level of change actually coming to fruition. And yes, it does afford us a higher quality of landscape, and it does afford us a higher quality of cultural facilities, and it does afford us beautiful spaces. And we don't think it completely destroys gargantuously, ridiculously, with the huge, monstrous, tall buildings, the centre of the town. We don't think that at all. In fact, no one did. We had four objections, and we actually had four letters of support, and we unanimously carried through for this consent, and we can't wait to get on with it, because it's genuinely relieving positive change. There's no way, frankly, just to put it right out there, with a mid-rise, compact, super-hugging, no-tall building scheme at 6 to 8 stories, could we have possibly have said to our client, hey, you know that bit of the site? Let's just give it away. What a cool idea. We don't need that. We don't need that piece. Let's just give it away so that we can build a three-form entry primary school. I think that's important, because otherwise there would not be a three-form entry primary school in the town centre. If we just hugged the ground, we couldn't possibly have created this multi-layered environment, which we think will be, I hope, as ambitious as the Barking was to my generation going forward to the next generation, in terms, but even better, because it actually stitches into the public realm seamlessly, tying together new spaces, new shopping, new culture, new opportunity for everybody. Tall buildings can be good. That's all I'm going to say. They can also be terrible.
Thank you very much, David. And now we look to the concept of digital model. And Gwyn Richards, Head of Design, City of London Corporation, is going to tell us what they're doing. Gwyn.
Good morning. I think I'm going to really fly through this. This is a summary of the modelling work that we've been doing on the city. It involves 3D modelling and other kinds of modelling. It's not just a visual modelling, but it's microclimatic modelling as well, is to allow us to make sense of that, to get this holistic idea of where we've been, where we're heading, where's the opportunities, where's the constraints, and so on. And we have a policy, a local-based policy in this area, which is the Eastern Cluster policy. It's the only policy area in the local plan at the moment which suggests tall buildings. It's always been there. It's been there for a good number of years, but I kind of realised a couple of years ago we've been developing this Eastern Cluster really as a result of applications and schemes coming in. So it's been a reactive process as opposed to us being proper planning and being proactive and understanding where we're heading with this and the vision and so on to sculpt the cluster and the various issues that the cluster has for us. So the first part of the initiative was to commission a three-dimensional model by GMJ. This model that you'll see here is all the schemes that's built, consented, and resolved to consent. Oops, I'll have to go back to that. So this is flying through the model. You can see the good connectivity of the cluster with all the kind of tube stations and the underground. It's the ideal place in terms of connectivity. What we wanted to understand is the nature of all of the constraints and all of the views that crisscross the city. So you've got these protected vistas firing across London. This is accelerated, I'm afraid. So it's focusing in on St. Paul's and there's one on the Tower of London. Look at these viewing corridors. The red is basically a no-go. The orange is generally no, but let's have a discussion. You can see the Eastern Cluster falls outside those areas, focusing in on St. Paul's and the Tower of London. The next slide, this is a rather messy slide. These are the assessment areas, which tend to be overlooked quite a bit, but these are qualitative points along the Thames in the LVMF, and we're going to have to work on this graphic, I think, but it just shows how the city is impacted on these views. And what we wanted to do was to have this journey along the kind of riverfront and understand, as a dynamic experience, how the cluster interrelates with St. Paul's, with Wren churches, with other kind of landmarks and so on. So this is a run through the entire the assessment points and other points along the Thames, picking up the views and understanding this kind of moving dynamic, not just along the Thames, but across London Bridge and towards the Tower of London and so on. So this is the approach across London Bridge, understanding how the relationship changes. And then this slide here is from the Tower of London, understanding the relationship of the cluster to the tower. There we've got the grandfather of all height constraints, which is St. Paul's height from the 30s. Very much, you shall not pass that red line, in essence. And the World Heritage Site and its local setting area and the views within, and then the monument views focusing on the cones, focusing southwest and east. Again, you can see the area of the tall buildings, they're missed out. We've got the 26 conservation areas, and then the 600 listed buildings, which by the very nature are constraints. And we've also got local views, one of which is particularly dear to us, which is the view from Ludgate. So this is you piling down Ludgate in a 70 miles per hour, but you can see the relationship of the cluster with St. Paul's and bathed in open sky. So this is the kind of very complex picture which we wanted to understand of the constraints, the interlayers of constraints and so on. And this is why, I mean, looking back and also looking forward, why the Eastern Cluster policy area is in the right place, which is very reassuring given that we've built the bloody thing. But what it enables us to do is to understand where within that cluster there's capacity for change, where the cluster needs to end. This is a view again from street level. We'll be doing a lot more street level views from the model to understand the local level impacts. So what we've got at the moment is a very good understanding, and there's a slide I can show you because it's still work in progress, which is a jelly mould, a kind of development blancmange over the cluster, which suggests that there are voids within the kind of the envelope where there's development potential. This is our kind of pressure valve. This is where we want the majority of commercial floor space. So we need to be able, from this model, we can understand how much floor space we can generate within these kind of view constraints. But there is sometimes an obsession with the skyline. I mean, my personal view is the sky belongs to everyone. It's a public asset. Nobody has a right to intrude upon that sky. Once you do that, you do have an impact on the public interest. But what we wanted to understand is the next level was to finish off on this point, which is the model did suggest certain parameters, certain aspirations which we've been developing, which is this is the aviation height limit, non-negotiable. This is the kind of an idea of the profile of the cluster that we view as the future, which is has a dynamic profile but leaves St. Paul's with a breathing space. And similarly, from the North Bastion of Tower Bridge, you've got, you can see a lot of the buildings actually fit into that kind of jelly mould as you were at the moment. There is a discussion as to what happens between the building that burns people, or did, and the cluster, and and I'll come on to that. That's another discussion and a debate to be had. The other element of this gives you the kind of viewing or the townscape impact of the scheme. What we wanted to understand is we've got 120 residential units within and around the cluster. Daylight sunlight is protected by policy to those within reason to those residential properties. So we've asked RWDI to map the cones. This is, if you can imagine, this is a three-dimensional fan emanating from one residential unit in Bevis Marks. And this suggests that anything that breaks that orange-yellow fan would be a negative impact, would be contentious in terms of daylight sunlight. And this is another example. This is from one unit, Bevis Mark. This is why provision of tall buildings for commercial uses and residentials, they don't sit very comfortably. I mean, you can see in this implication on one building, and we've got 120 of these to map. This will then be fed into the model to understand where these kind of voids, where we could actually provide commercial floor space, is being compromised by these kind of daylight sunlight angles. It informs where we should be allowing residential. It informs our approach to the future of existing residential units and so on. So as you've heard, the majority of tall buildings in London are residential. In the city, they're very much are a restriction or a constraint upon residential. The other thing that we wanted to develop in the three-dimensional model was understanding the impact of a cluster of tall buildings on the public realm. The population of the city is going to increase from 400,000 to 500,000 in the next 15, 20 years. The public realm is immensely important. And what we wanted to understand is the cumulative impact of all of these tall buildings on wind patterns as a starting point. It's been a very contentious issue, quite rightly. You're always going to get wind with tall buildings because they deflect wind. It doesn't matter if they're individuals or in clusters, and that's just fact. We're an island on the Atlantic, so we are relatively windy. But what we did, this is the model that we've got commissioned in RWDI, it's living in Milton Keynes in a wind tunnel. What we asked RWDI to do is to just let's get some kind of reality check here. Where do we compare with other cities around the world? And we tested 30, 40 cities. I won't even show Wellington, it's X-rated. But this is New York. You can see if we apply the London climate to New York, that the red and the yellows are, certainly the reds are the areas where we certainly want to avoid. Those are almost health and safety issues. So we're not a particularly aggressive and windy city, but obviously these tall buildings have an impact. Historically, what we've been doing as applications come in, as anybody dealing with tall buildings, there's an EIA which includes wind modelling. We've really had to work hard to refine that kind of level of supporting information, not just a wind model, but now CFD testing and so on. So what we've got is a number of jigsaw pieces, and we're filling the gap between the jigsaw pieces to get this kind of holistic view of these interrelated buildings and the macro level impact of the wind and so on. And I think I win for cute slides, but in broad brush terms, effectively the cluster is operating like huddled penguins. The wind is buffeting around or is accelerated around the cluster, and the area in the middle is tranquil. I think we're probably overstating the wind chill on that one. But and this is from our three-dimensional CFD model, computer fluid dynamics. The green areas, as you can see, the huddled penguins, the green areas is where the wind is deflected around the periphery of the cluster. So the areas to the east, Aldgate Square, for example, and in and around the Gherkin, they're much more tranquil. They've been calmed down by the buildings on the western periphery. And this is a very important lesson for us. what it does indicate as well is that we've been very, very good at protecting the pedestrian environment of the pavements. What we've not been very good at is we've deflected the problem onto the roads, which you might say, well, you're not going to be sitting in the middle of the carriageway in Bishopsgate having a coffee. But these arterial roads are absolutely critical in terms of potential pedestrianisation, traffic calming, but increasingly cycling. What we've got is enhanced wind conditions along the main cycle kind of arteries of the city. So what we're doing at the moment with the new university and RWDI is coming up with the first internationally cycling criterion wind to understand not just the health and safety aspects of wind on cycling, but also the comfort level and what we should be aspiring to. So this is an example of the huddled penguin. So you can see the various schemes deflect the winds around the cluster, which was one of the key kind of, and you can see the area around is tranquil. This is one of the kind of localized issues which we were doing the more work. This is between the old Hearn Tower, 100 Bishopsgate, which is the funneling effect. And we're particularly concerned about this effect on this junction, because there is a rapid acceleration, high cycle path center point every day. On a windy day, you get buffeted. I'm getting somebody saying stop, but I'm just going to really rush through this. This shows how a building can break up. This is the Willis building, can break up wind. So that's been very educational for us. We're now going to model up the impact of the wind model with air pollution. So this shows the comparison between the wind levels and the pollution. The dark is very polluted. We think that the work on the wind model will actually cleanse the pollution in this area, which is work we're doing. We're also mapping the sunlight hitting the streets. So we can see where the tall buildings impact on these very valuable public realm. This is again the view of the area. You can see Bank Junction, which I know is very dear to Peter, and Aldgate Gyratory or Aldgate Square are very high sunlight levels. And then we're going to add noise into the mix as well to come up with a combination of various to index the public realm and the impact of tall buildings with sunlight. This is Aldgate sunlight, wind, sunlight, noise and air pollution to come up with something which we've had discussions with Colin and the GLA, these kind of hard-hitting new comfort criteria to actually have a planning tool to actually inform future tall buildings and how they impact on the public realm. So it's not just the visual, it's the microclimatic and the holistic impact of tall buildings. And I've seen the stop thing on down, but I will finish. So this is where we're at. So this is what we're modelling and to understand how we can actually add to that without compromising the larger, wider public interest.
Great, thank you very much, Gwyn. That's a super tool, and I hope we can get one of those for the whole of London soon. Now, we're going to have a discussion in a minute, but first I'd like to ask Brad Bennetts, who was going to be in the discussion, but he's got to go and catch a plane, and we're running a little behind. Yeah. So he's going to give his bit now and then go, and then we'll have the discussion.
I'm really sorry I've got to rush off, but I've got to get to Edinburgh for a client meeting, and I'm not putting up a tower in Edinburgh, I promise you. But anyway, the thing that I thought I would add to the panel discussion, and I'm sorry it's not in the format that was intended, is how I came to a view about a concern about the character of London. I mean, I went to Miffin for the first and probably the last time about 2 years ago, and I was very struck by the fact that London and Paris and Belgrade and some cities in Australia and the Far East and one in America too, all the cities were basically trying to do the same thing, which is to push upwards and make their big display of corporate wealth through glassy towers. And it struck me that every city in that mix was losing its distinctiveness, including London. And I was thinking, why on earth would you try to make all the cities on the planet look the same? It seems that the cities have all got particularly distinguishing characteristics. London, of course, has got many. So I came back thinking that London is beginning to destroy itself, actually, by having so many tall buildings in a random policy that it's starting to erode the very character that we like about the place. And that's not to say that some towers are not successful, because they are. I mean, the city cluster is pretty good, and I think Canary Wharf is pretty good in its own way too. But the number of consents and the effect on London as a whole, I thought, was pretty devastating. So I started thinking about, well, what is it about the character of London? Like a conservation area, could we describe in a statement what is it about London that is something worth preserving so that we don't lose the proverbial baby with the bathwater? And of course, it is a river valley. It's a very wide, broad river valley with a river snaking through the middle. It's its single biggest feature. It has hills in the distance. Most of them are wooded, and you can look into the city from those wooded hills. It's full of parks, and it's got avenues, and it's got gardens, and it's got distinguished buildings and so on, mostly along the river, incidentally. And so there are certain things about that that you would not want to destroy. So looking from the wooded hills into the city, for example, those views, I would argue, are important, and you don't want to wreck it. So if you were to build up a policy for where the tall buildings should go and where they're not helpful, you would start with a character statement, and you would then come to a conclusion that, for example, perimeter buildings are okay probably in the city, but the ones along the river most definitely aren't. And I looked at the Blackfriars cluster the other day and got really depressed about it, because it seemed that was destroying the idea of seeing the river in a valley in the middle of London. So rather than doing it borough by borough, which of course is what we do, or application by application, we have to develop a character policy for the whole of London that people can buy into. And I'm not just talking about those of us making applications, I'm talking about the citizens of London and those who use London from all over the world and who come into London and observe every time how green it is and how low-lying and how pleasant. And that's why people come to the city, and let's not just lose the baby with the bathwater. That was my little 2-minute slot. I hope that was okay. And then I've got to run. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rab. So now we are going to have a discussion with some of the speakers from the last session, and they will be joined by Colin Wilson, who's Strategic Planning Manager, GLA, Emily G, London Planning Director, Historic England, Andy Reid, Design and Planning Director of Mount Anville, and Barbara Weiss, who is the co-founder of the Skyline Campaign. So if everyone could just grab a seat there, then we'll have a bit of a discussion, and there'll be a chance for you to ask questions. So, Emily, if I can start with you on your thoughts of perhaps what you've heard and how planning can assist in delivering positive impact for new developments in London.
Great. Thank you, Peter. Well, I think perhaps contrary to some perceptions in the room, Historic England is not against tall buildings as a matter of principle. And we think that they can indeed contribute to the vitality of urban life in London in particular, but they must be in the right place and they must be well designed. And that is, of course, one of our roles is to comment on that. What is so important, of course, in London, as Rab has just touched on, is about prospect and views. And so siting is really important. And our role is to think very closely about where, if indeed there is harm, and to say so when there is, while also accepting that some buildings can indeed contribute to vitality. They have a wide impact, and it's important to think about that impact. And I think I agree very much with what Gwyn was saying about the importance of the skyline belonging to all of us. There is kind of collective ownership of that, and we have a role to play in advising that make sure that harm does not come into play there. So planning is really important. There are a number of ways, I think, that we can work on that. One is by having, again, as Rab has just touched on, a London-wide, a pan-London view about where placement of tall buildings. And that's a role to play for GLA there, of course. We think that there should be character-led approaches to both that pan-London view as well as to local plans. And this can lead us to a place of good growth, a current word, which I think is a really important one, showing that densification can be found in many ways, not just through height. We agree very much with the idea about 3D modelling. I think it's a really useful planning tool. We're really keen to see that adopted across London so that we can all look at the impact of tall buildings, particularly considering, of course, from our point of view, historic environment considerations. We also think that we, through planning, can ask Londoners more about what they think. Involve in consultation what types of buildings do people want to live in and work in. I think we should involve Londoners more so in that process. And lastly, I think just come back to that point about views, which is so important, I think quite fundamental to us, about thinking about views, protecting those, and we're really glad that the Mayor has agreed to look at the LBMF, and I think that protecting those enduring and cherished views of the historic environment of London is a really important planning tool in shaping the future of the city.
Great. Thank you, Emily. Now, Andy, perhaps I could ask you, I mean, we've heard had a question already about people living in these towers. Can you tell us a bit about who's buying, who's moving in, and how they work as places to live?
Yes, sure. Morning, everybody. At Mount Anvil, we are fortunate enough to be developing a whole range of, a very diverse range of properties, from five Grade 2 listed buildings in Camden through to some, I think, superb tall buildings in Lambeth and across to Tower Hamlets. All designed, all of our activity is based in central London. As with all of the diverse buildings that we're delivering, we certainly find that there is no standard purchaser. The purchaser profile varies enormously, both in terms of age, sex, and status. One of the really interesting bits of feedback that we get from our purchasers, when they're sort of going through their decision-making process, is really first and foremost about the location of the property. So where do they want to live? And that comes above whether or not a building is tall or not. The second sort of category is that of price. And obviously, price points can vary hugely in different parts of London and, of course, across boroughs. Price is a huge influencer in terms of people's decision-making process also. In terms of, say, the people who've done surveys of people who actually have bought in tall buildings, the type of purchaser is also really quite diverse. I mean, we get downsizers in the same tower as, say, city bankers. And so I think the only conclusion is that there is no standard purchaser, which is great news, I think, as a developer. It means that we appeal to the broadest possible purchaser base.
Thank you very much. Barbara, you've been leading the Skyline campaign almost since we brought out the first results of the report, before, really, you're interested in this. But there's a lot of agreement, good buildings in the right place. How do you think tall buildings have any role to play in terms of delivering London's growth?
So I would start by saying that I agree with Emily that the Skyline campaign is not anti-tower. I personally have lived many years in New York and can say that I really have enjoyed working and living in tall buildings. It's really coming back to the issue of the character of cities, and I think London has its own specific DNA, which only allows for very few number of tall buildings, I'd say, as exceptions. And given the forest of new buildings that we're facing, I'm very concerned that if we continue the kind of trend that we're seeing year on year coming here, very soon we will be left with a city which is totally different. And I can't say that I saw a single slide this morning that filled my heart with joy. There was a huge number of very, very ordinary commercial buildings that you can see are being put up for financial reasons and not because they're contributing in any way to city building or improving London. And I brought my three slides. Can we get this one on too? Okay, so I was allowed three slides, not a lot, this one is pretty self-evident. I nearly had a heart attack when I came around the corner at the Design Museum and saw this. Obviously, they didn't have a 3D model at the time when the walkie-talkie was consented, but I think this is absolutely shocking. And coming back to David West's presentation, I completely agree with you that there are good towers and bad towers, but the reason we called Chiswick a monster is because you could see it from all across Kew Gardens, you could see it from conservation areas, you could see it from all kinds of places where you wouldn't particularly want to see a 32-story tower in the background. Barking does not have that problem. So I suppose that's why you have four people opposing as opposed to hundreds in queue. This is another reason why we are very disappointed with what's going on. This is the view that I get from my office every day. It's the Albert Embankment. And worse and worse buildings are going up. The slide that we showed earlier about the long, flat skyline was so much nicer than what we're getting now, and we're getting worse still. And this is finally coming back to this point of generic city. We are totally against generic city. And I was interested that one of the first talks of the session, somebody said, we do ask people who live in the towers whether they like them or not. But do you ever go around and ask people who live around the base of the towers whether their bit of city has been improved or not? And my perception is that there are more and more groups of local residents who really do not want to live in the shadow of some big commercial tower that has been built to live 60 years. We know it's going to deteriorate. We know it's going to be incredibly expensive to maintain. We know that a lot of flats are not being used, and it's not making London a better city.
Thank you, Barbara. Colin, I mean, obviously, you see a lot of these coming in front of your desk. What are you going to do about it?
I'm a planner, and you may recollect there was a plan for London in 2004 which promoted tall buildings in certain locations. There was another plan for London in 2008 which promoted tall buildings in the same locations. And there was another plan in 2011 which said tall buildings had a place in London, and that place was in the same locations as the first three London plans. And in 2009 we drew out a plan of where existing clusters were and where new clusters would be, and it was the same plan that Nigel showed. So to get things done, to get Chiswick Curve done, to get anything built, you need a propositional plan, and I'm, from my perspective, kind of job done, really. We have tall buildings where democratically elected mayors wanted them to be, where democratically elected local politicians wanted them to be. We are quite keen to do a 3D model, but evidence bases do not make decisions. 3D models do not make decisions. Unless you haven't noticed, politicians generally make decisions. I don't make decisions, I make recommendations. So I think, London has been a tremendous success. I was up at the top earlier this week of 33 Cavendish Square, probably one of the most ugly tall buildings in London, but one of the most hard to see tall buildings in London. Surprisingly, it's on Cavendish Square. It's just on the ridgeline of the Roman Road on Oxford Street, probably one of the reasons why it is a bit tough to see. But the view from there is absolutely fantastic of a very varied London. You can look north to Hampstead Heath, and it's all completely green. You can look out to Hyde Park, and it's kind of low-rise conservation areas. And then you can look down to Vauxhall, Nine Elms, the city, and out to the east. And that's a tremendous variety. I think that's a distinct character. It doesn't look generic. It doesn't look like any other city. If it did, I don't think the numbers of people coming here as tourists would keep going up year on year on year. And in fact, Barbara's photo of the shocker, the walkie-talkie. Can I just confess, I really like the walkie-talkie. When Ken Livingston saw it, he really didn't like it. I think I was the only person in the office who did, possibly the only person in this room who likes it, but I really do like it. In fact, when we showed Ken Livingston the model of the walkie-talkie, the architects brought in this huge wooden model, and so he came down with Neil Coleman to have a look at it, because he was so concerned about it. And what we did is we shifted all the towers around on the model before we came down to see if anyone would notice. We were talking about it for about 5 minutes before we confessed that we'd moved all the towers around. And you think, all right, okay. But there's an important point there. I think people, obsess, I think slightly overly, about tall buildings in a world city. We're in a city of 8-9 million people, one of the world's great cities. Oh my word, there are 450 tall buildings in it. Shocker. Please. The population's going up 10, 11 million. It's all being done to a plan which I think could be better. I think we've got to a point where we've got Mark IV London plan we've done 2015. If you think of a Ford Cortina, you only got up to Mark IV, and then time has moved on, and they need to do something else. I think we've got into that same place with London plan. We need to do a different kind of London plan, which does need to be, I think, more propositional, more directional. It does need to be more open with Londoners about what that change will be. Absolutely get that point and agree that point. And it does need to be more accessible, more, less jargon, I think more maps of where this stuff is, and just everybody will like all plans, that will never happen. At least we can be open and honest about where London's growth is going to go in the future.
Thank you, Colin. Could I just ask you, you said, I hope we can do a model. Did you say we are going to do a model?
An interesting point on 3D modelling. So for quite a few years, we've been talking about getting a 3D model together. And then about 4 months ago, we discovered that CFL had a whole team of people with 3D modelling tucked under a stairway somewhere in Windsor House that nobody told anyone about. So one of the things, and the reason they have that is because when they're teaching their bus drivers and tube drivers, they have sort of simulators. That sort of stuff. They also have a mapping of all the underground kit. So they've got they have the actual hardware to support this, and a little team of people doing it. So one of the things we're exploring with them and with other authorities and with other providers is how we could get that, particularly online. You'd think it'd be easy. I think it would be easy, but actually it's quite tricky to get that heavy data in a kind of online form. But it would be great if you could get it, you know, on your phone or your iPad. And it would at least help everybody access the debates about Chiswick Curve. And, you know, is it, you know, where can you see it from Kew Gardens? Is it, you know, just a more accessible way to get people into that debate. So it's not just dominated by, you know, one or two crazy people like me or Barbara or David. that must be a right thing, you know. But why can't people get access to this thing more easily? I mean, sometimes I struggle to get access to it. It's kind of my job.
Okay. Well, hopefully we can get something moving after this meeting. But one of the things that comes a number of times is characters. So I just warn the panel that just before we finish the discussion, I can ask each of you to sum up in just a couple of sentences what you see as the sort of key character of London that needs to be protected in the way that Rab did at the beginning. But let's open it to the floor and ask questions. I know Robert told me there were a couple of hands over in that side of the room. Gentleman at the front was first in the queue, apparently, so yes.
Hello, I'm Andrew Wood, councillor for Canary Wharf Ward. We're the experts in tall buildings, as you might have noticed from the earlier presentations. Just for people to know, we're actually going to do lots of survey work on the Isle of Dogs this year to answer some of those questions about who lives in these buildings, what they think about them, and what they think they need, because we're working also on a neighbourhood plan for the Isle of Dogs. We're also in Regulation 14 consultation right now. And one of the things we've made mandatory in that plan is the requirement for everything to be done in 3D modelling. So the question for the panel is twofold. What other things would you like to see in a 3D model? And how do we ensure consistency across London? Because lots of people are talking about 3D models, GLA, TfL, Southwark, City of London. So how do we all make sure that we're singing off the same hymn sheet when we're talking to developers about 3D models?
Right, who'd like to start? David, you start on that one.
In terms of a 3D model, I think I would probably reiterate that, in my opinion, the most important thing of any piece of urbanity, whatever the height, is actually the first three floors, because that really is what any member of the public will actually be interfacing with. And so to me, the benefit of a 3D model would be able to slice everything off at a certain point by a switch of a button and actually see what's going on the ground and what's interfacing with the public realm, because actually too many towers are landing with too much lack of clarity, I suppose, or too little clarity in terms of the quality of their footing and in terms of the active frontage and the way that the place works. So I think that would be a real benefit.
Who else would like to take on that one?
Yes, just to comment, I agree David, with David's comments, but I think also to have a 3D model of London in its entirety, say held by the GLA, that we can sort of access to support pre-apps and live applications would be hugely beneficial to our business the development world in general, I would say. It would also, I think, help, I suppose, sort of prove or disprove of a lot of people's concerns, and that's got to be a good thing.
Barbara.
So I I think we lament the lack of vision and of planning in terms of urban design, because it seems as if these towers, and not just the towers, are just plonked on any site that somebody owns, and then they look at their own building, they don't look at their neighbours, they don't look at how things join up. And for instance, one of the reasons New York works so well with so many towers is because you get this plinth. So the lower floors create a street, and then the towers do their own business above, which is fine. And then you can get wacky towers, but you have the nice order, which relates to people who are walking, cycling, going to shops, and so on. So I think it's not just a question of having a model that reacts to what's being built, but it's planners at the GLA who are actually planning London. Nobody is planning London at the moment. And I totally disagree with the opportunity areas. I disagree with clusters. If you look at a cluster, it's just a jumble of shapes. Each building is different. There's no communal language of what we're aiming for with London and its four buildings.
Emily.
I think with modelling, what we're seeing are some really sophisticated ways to identify impact. And so I think it's really important to have the heritage considerations flagged so that we can see, you know, where all the list of buildings are, where all the conservation areas are, where the views are, so that we can all together look with a sort of constant baseline about the impact on those really special parts of London about new tall buildings. And as I said, there's some really sophisticated ways of doing that now, but it'd be great to have one common baseline if the GLA could own that, that we could all feed into, particularly at pre-app stage. I think that'd be extraordinarily useful.
Yeah, agreed.
So, Gwyn, from your experience of the model, how realistic is to get this to operate across London, but also in that communal language, which Barbara talked about, because you have experience of Westminster, but also the city, where actually every building tries to be different.
I think we've been having discussions with Colin about this concept of a London-wide model, which I know there's been discussions over a number of years on that. What we've realised in the 2 years that we've been developing the model is, don't look at it as a visual tool. It's not a kind of sexy way of visualising the world around us to make us seem as if we know what we're talking about. It's a holistic tool which can bring in microclimatic elements, daylight, sunlight to residential, and it has the potential of being an absolutely holistic planning tool to inform any development.
Yeah.
Very good. Right, another question. Gosh, there's lots. Is gentleman just back there and the lady in front?
Yeah, good morning. It's Steve McAdam from Fluid. Two questions, if I can. I'll keep them quick. The first is to do with a comment when asked to talk about London and its distribution of buildings and tall buildings, is that London, he said, is a lovely mess and we should celebrate it. That was from Peter Stewart. So hard to turn that into any policy, maybe it shouldn't be, but I thought it'd be interesting to have comments on that take on London. The second question, much more germane to this morning's debate, I think, is about quality. And I think it's always an issue when the word is used. It seems that it passes as a universal standard, where of course it's not, and as David amply showed, even geographically, there may be very different ideas as to what quality is. It reminded me of Robert Persig's book, Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance, which sets out to establish what quality is, and after 700 pages and 2,500 miles, he's none the wiser. So the question is, nonetheless, how do we define quality from a planning perspective? What do we think good looks like in those terms? Thanks.
Right. Well, I think we'll come back to both of those. One lovely mess, I think, if you pick that up in the character piece, I'll ask you to talk about it in a minute, and quality, I think, we'll come to. But let's just take this lady here.
Liz Walton from the Battersea Society. There's been one noticeable absence from the discussion this morning, and that is how you actually move from these clusters and centres and densification actually around the city. We've watched in Nine Elms and Battersea over the last 10 years a massive densification right from Wandsworth Town Centre with the Ram development right through to along the Albert Embankment, virtually to Waterloo. It's noticeable that travel times have increased, and we have persistently argued that there should be much greater strategic modelling of the impact of this increase in residential population on the main traffic routes in the public transport. Increasingly, as been pointed out on a number of times this morning,
each development seems to be discrete and related to what the existing public transport road capacity is, without any overall strategic view of how these will knit together and make an impact locally. I mean, just to take a very brief example.
Actually, just put a question, because I think it's quite clear that...
What I'm really asking is the GLA, whether in fact, and the boroughs, have the extent to which they're working with TfL to produce a strategic overview. I know I'm looking with anticipation to what's happening in Vauxhall.
Colin, how do you bring all this together?
So for all the opportunity areas, we do very detailed transport studies and look at transport mitigation. We did that for Vauxhall Line Elms back in 2009. That's where the Northern Line extension idea came out of. Not just the Northern Line extension, but also bus improvements to bus, mitigation to road transport. Is it a challenge? Of course it is, because the whole city's growing. And actually what TfL did off the back of Vauxhall Line Elms was then look at the wider West London, because obviously you can't do these areas just in isolation because they're part of a wider transport road network. Does that mean that there aren't any problems, or that there aren't increasing challenges as the population goes up to 9, 10 million people? Of course there are. But it is looked at as an integrated part of the plan, not as something that's kind of left over. And that includes things like the strategy for dealing with actually the construction traffic, of which an enormous amount of work gets done. And just going back to the point of Gwyn's point, actually, and I think part of an issue is how you get that information out there. There is an enormous amount of planning going on in London. I mean, so much is hard to keep up with. But it's often very hard to access. I find it interesting to think nothing's been done about that, because...
It's very difficult to access that information if you're a local resident.
No, that I absolutely get, which is a great shame, because lots of people are spending, lots of officers I think spending lots of time looking at that stuff, trying to solve it, and maybe sometimes so much time that you forget to communicate that, and I can see some other people who seem to have been involved in that kind of work.
Right, let's have another question. Barbara, okay, yes.
I feel that another thing that hasn't been mentioned before is the fact that the population growth, and whether the population growth will happen given Brexit, we don't know. But everybody thinks it has to occur in central London. The Skyline campaign is very much pushing for outer London to shoulder some of its responsibility in taking this growth. There's a huge area out there which could be developed very sensitively with either dense low-rise or mid-rise, and with the occasional tower, because, as we say, there is the place for the occasional tower. But to think that we have to put thousands and thousands of more people in central London is just an excuse. It's a post-rationalisation for more towers, and that's what Westminster is trying to do with its new consultation, which is very worrying.
I feel sure the new London plan will be more polycentric than previous ones. We have a question here.
Peter Everston, London Forum. What Emily and Barbara said about context and character is really important, and we're glad that Sadiq Khan is also emphasising that. But David, you demonstrated something that worries us very much in the communities I represent. You can do superb creation of new character and context in brownfield areas like Dagenham and Barking, but then you can spot a postage stamp sized piece of land in Brentford and propose a Chiswick curve, which is completely alien to the context and character that exists and might harm the setting of the World Heritage Site, and certainly alien to what people really would like to see as a development. And I wonder why architects do that.
Peter,
the question
please.
Is, why do architects do that? Why do they just...
Right, David, why do architects do that?
Well, I'm multi-layered. I mean, I must be getting to wrapping up on the character bit, isn't it?
Well,
multi-layered
answer. You can leave your answer to
number
your
one.
To the end,
I, number one, I'm an urban designer, not an architect. So I can't speak upon behalf of architects. That would be unprofessional of me. On behalf of urban designers, and I forgive me, Peter, I think I have to answer this question with my character.
All right, okay,
fine,
okay.
Because I've actually thought about this, and for me, there's two things here. There's clarity and clarifications that I think are really important, and then there's an understanding of the character of London. It's important. I'm actually quite a supporter of the Skyline campaign in many ways. And yet, I'm not a supporter in some respects because I believe that there's sort of blanket that's not acceptable, it can't work, it won't work, it's harmful that's used. And for example, in Barking, it seems okay to everybody that that's all right. In fact, I've even heard that it's all okay. And yet, we thought a great deal about the Skyline in Barking. We thought a great deal about the conservation area that sits immediately adjacent to our site, much closer to our site than the conservation area areas in Chiswick and in Brentford. I'm talking like as close as Sandra is to me to the site, is the conservation area in Barking. Is that any less important than the conservation area in Chiswick? Discuss. I really don't think it is. And the River Thames is close, and I can see the site from the River Thames. Yes, the site in Barking from the River Thames. I can see the site from the Barking Creek. I can see the site from the Abbey Park, Barking Abbey grounds. Incredibly important, strategically important site and listed structure and important views. Is that any less important than, or any more important actually, than any of the parks and gardens in the west of London? And then I hear it would have been visible all over Kew Gardens, as if it's an absolute fact. That's not a fact at all. We strategically made sure that our building, the Chiswick Curve, is absolutely sculpted with Richard Coleman outside of any particular strategic views that are acknowledged, listed, important strategic structures or views of Kew Gardens. That was deliberate. That's what's called townscape appraisal, and it's an incredibly important part of our profession, and we responded utterly to that, and it's utterly sculpted because of those views. You can see a myriad of tall buildings already from Kew Gardens, and there's lots and lots of points where you can see nothing but trees, and that's fantastic. That's what's called life. And so for me, the good design, good urban design and good architectural design takes every single site and says, this is the reality of the economic situation. This is what the site is worth. This is what a client wants to put on it. And in the end, something's going to be there. Our job is not to argue about a big lump. Our job is to sculpt a big lump. Our job is to care about the public realm of that big lump. Our job is to make that big lump turn into something far more elegant. And our job is to care immensely about the conservation areas, the communities, the parks and gardens, and those rules and views, and to sculpt them. And it's too easy to just blanket things and say, oh, it's harmful, it's significant harm. What does that mean? And at what point does a modern building not actually add something to a new area? And I'm afraid it's all too easy to say, West London, the conservation areas are here, and forget the conservation areas of East London, of South London, of North London. London, to answer the question about of character, is utterly diverse. Gloriously messy and gloriously multitudinal in terms of its character. It's also absolutely jam-packed full of conservation areas. And I do not believe that the conservation areas in and around Brentford and Kew are any more important than the conservation areas in Barking or anywhere else in London. And for me, taking conservation seriously is as important as taking new building seriously. And for me, the most powerful, most beautiful character of London is it's constantly evolving. And the day that London stops evolving, the day London dies. And the whole of London should be allowed to evolve equally, in my opinion. Otherwise, it's going to look like that in the future. And that's weird.
Thank you. Right. Emily, you want to say something? We have one last question there, and then we'll... Emily, you want to say something on that?
I do, thank you. Just to come back on the point about conservation areas, and then we don't think some are better than others or more important than others. It's all about the character of that particular place, and some are more accommodating of certain types of growth than others. And I think that's, we haven't got a blanket response. We look very carefully at each individual place, the impact on the setting of the places around it, those two buildings or the conservation areas, and some will be perfectly accommodating of certain types of change and others aren't. And we welcome change, but we also need to think really carefully about the special character of all parts of London.
Thank you very much. Yes, last question here.
Old English architect. Peter talked about tower blocks in Hackney being blown up. Barbara talked about 60-year life for buildings. We ourselves are designing what we call the Flexi Tower that is going to be totally demolished at the end of its life. We're talking about the circular economy. In your design, how simple are your buildings to demolish at the end of its life?
Love that question. I'd prefer them not to be demolished. I'd prefer them to be... I would prefer them to evolve.
I love, and my business partner Christoph Egret loves too. As a studio, we love the idea that we are not in any way so arrogant to think that our buildings are complete, or ever should they be complete, and places will never be complete either, and they should continue to evolve. So we love the idea and aspire to our buildings having second, third, and fourth lives, which is why we roll up our sleeves and work on projects like the Balfron Tower, Erno Goldfinger's very challenging building over in Poplar, which we don't think should just be left as it is, completely falling apart, but actually given a second life. And so all of the structures we consider are always designed for that robustness and flexibility of future use.
But not many are. I'm delighted at the Goldfinger's being brought back to life, but the trouble is the quality of most towers will not allow for life after 60 years.
But that's for designers and developers to work together.
We're getting near the end, but can we just go along the line, as I warned you all, just two sentences on what you see as the sort of character that we've heard about, glorious, messy, diverse Sandra. What's your take on London?
I think London's a really walkable place, and actually what we continue to do is reclaim all that road network from traffic. And I think if we did that, then more people would enjoy London streets, we would return some of London streets to their former glory, that would create the setting for all kinds of range of development, very diverse. So for me, London is walkable, and we need to try and sustain that, but also try and reclaim the streets for that purpose, and that's why at Lambeth we're pushing ahead with our gyratory projects to reclaim some of that space.
Reclaim the streets, yes.
It's the quality of its historic architecture, which is very diverse, in some ways very consistent, in some ways very different, and it's the streets.
For us, it's all about leaving a positive legacy, and it's creating places where people want to live, work, and really enjoy their lives in what is the best city in the world.
London's character is defined by its sweeping views. It's a really fortuitous topography for prospects, and that's really important. It also has a wonderfully diverse range of architectural monuments, from the grand to the ordinary, across all time periods, ancient through to post-war and recent. And also, I think the character is defined by the very hard-working nature of the people that are here, the culturally richness of that, and the great diversity of that. I think all of those aspects are really reflected in the historic environment and built environment. That's important to keep.
Thank you very much. Colin.
Yeah, I think London's character is gloriously messy. It's been affirmed. And I think that reflects its political traditions, its traditions of a free and liberal culture. And I think that's what really underpins this city. That's why I moved here. That's why I stay here. And you know, architecture, urbanism, it's a social thing. You know, it's not a natural thing. It comes from us. And I think London skyline reflects that. And I really enjoy it. It's a brilliant place to live in and be in and be part of what's happening at the moment.
I'm going to answer the question to the City of London. I think the City of London's character, the beating heart of the city, is the historic environment. That's why people visit, that's why people want to invest. But in order to protect that, you need to have a pressure valve of an area which can constantly evolve, which is the enduring legacy of London. It constantly evolves.
Thanks.
Peter, can I offer one clarification on something I said earlier, please, to the audience?
Yes.
I said that there were 400 objections for the Chiswick Curve. News just in from my project architect was there. There are actually 687 objections. but importantly, and please take this seriously, 198 people bothered to write letters of support. And I don't know many planning applications that get 198 letters of support. So in the same way that the 48% of us in this country that voted to remain aren't being heard, 198 people supported that tall building, and I think that's quite an important thing to think about.
Like a new mayor supported that building as well.
The new mayor supported. Okay, well, some like them, some don't, obviously. So I've never quite seen them as huddled penguins, but I thought the jelly mould idea is really good because that does actually how you shape the city. And in my view, the City of London always had a jagged profile, unlike Paris or Bordeaux or classical cities, and it has a jagged skyline to this day. And I thought one of the interesting things
I mean, opportunity areas obviously key, but larger areas development. London Borough of Night Dragon, I thought, was a masterstroke. Stewart, who couldn't quite remember, think of a name quickly enough, he told me while I was sitting next to him, London Borough of Barclay would be another one. Because these are places which are creating complete clusters that we need to be absolutely sure we are getting the character right for London, whatever that character is. We've got quite a lot of variety across our panel, but that's all a part of the debate. This is a really important time for this study to come out because, as we've discussed, the new London plan is being thought about in City Hall, will be drafted later on this year. So everyone's input is really important. And so you've got a bit of evidence base, which is really important, isn't it, Colin? Here we are. You'll be able to pick up the report on your way out and stay involved in the debate. Thank you all very much.